In the day's other news, it was primary eve in Wisconsin, and the campaigning went almost nonstop. On the Republican side, both Donald Trump and Ted Cruz predicted victory. And Democrat Bernie Sanders talked of scoring a win over frontrunner Hillary Clinton. We'll get a report from Wisconsin and review the race in general later in the program. Two big state governors signed bills today, taking their minimum wage to the highest in the nation. In California, the state live-streamed Governor Jerry Brown's signing of a new law, which by 2022 will raise the wage from $10 to $15 an hour.
This is about economic justice. It's about people. It's about creating a little tiny balance in a system that every day becomes more unbalanced.
And in New York, Governor Andrew Cuomo signed a bill setting a $15 minimum for New York City and its suburbs by 2021. The rest of the state will rise to $12.50 an hour. President Obama today commended the state efforts. He urged Congress to hike the federal minimum as well. The Supreme Court has unanimously upheld a Texas law in the latest battle over legislative districts. The law counts overall population, not just eligible voters, in drawing districts. Challengers said that means some end up with far more voters than others. But the court ruled the method does not violate the principle of one person, one vote. Amtrak trains in the Northeast are back on normal schedules after Sunday's collision that killed two maintenance workers. It happened when a southbound train struck heavy maintenance equipment and derailed outside Philadelphia. CNN reported today the maintenance workers were on the wrong track, but it remains unclear why. Brussels' main airport ramped up departures today after partially reopening on Sunday. The facility had been closed since last month's attacks. Security was tight today as passengers went through stricter check-in procedures. Many said it's about pushing on in spite of the terrorists.
It's terribly sad what happened at the airport. And my first reaction was not to go on holiday anymore. But after a couple of days, I thought that life should go on and that we have to resume all activities. We have to straighten our backs and go on.
20 flights were scheduled to leave today, up from three yesterday. Officials say it will be months before full service is restored. In Iraq, a string of suicide attacks killed 29 people. At least 14 died at a restaurant that's popular with Shiite fighters in the south. And in Basra, a car bomb in a commercial district left five dead. Search teams sifted through the charred hulks of cars looking for victims. Islamic State extremists claim responsibility for most of the attacks. Back in this country, a new analysis finds prices of widely used medications have shot up sharply in 5 years. Reuters reports manufacturers of four of the top 10 drugs in the U.S. raised prices by more than 100% since 2011. The cost of six other medicines increased by more than 50% in that time. Among them, the arthritis drugs Humira and Enbrel and the asthma drug Advair. Heart patients have some new developments to talk over with their doctors. Findings published this week show anti-cholesterol statin drugs can prevent heart attacks even in patients with only a borderline risk. And for those who don't tolerate statins well, another study finds an alternative is showing promise. It's known as a PCSK9 inhibitor. BP's record settlement over the 2010 Gulf oil spill has cleared its final hurdle. A federal judge in New Orleans today approved the roughly $20 billion deal. Much of it will go to state and local governments. In 2012, BP reached a similar settlement on private damage claims. And on Wall Street, the Dow Jones Industrial Average lost more than 55 points to close at 17,737. The NASDAQ fell 22 points, and the S&P slipped six.